Let's talk about composite functions. I have an expression written here that would be read as f of g of x. And what that means is that g of x is a function that is inside of another function that we would call f of x. And let me give you a visual to kind of explain what this means. Let's say that I have this function machine that I'm going to call g. And then I have another function machine that I'm going to call f. Now we have x values that are input into the function g. And when they come out of that function g, those x values are now g of x. Whatever the function g does to x, that's what comes out. Then that output, g of x, becomes the input into f. And then the function f does whatever it does to the input. And the output is f of g of x. So the idea here is that instead of an input x, we have an input that's actually a function of x. Let's look at some examples of how this works. On your handout in the first example, we have the function f of x equal to 2x squared minus 3, and the function g of x equal to 4x. I believe that is a typo on your handout. It says g of x equals 4. It should be g of x equals 4x. So go ahead and add a little x next to that 4. And the first part of this problem, we're asked to determine f of g of 1. And what that means is that the value 1, we're going to input that value into g of x. So 1 is going to become an input to g of x. And then whatever we get out of that function will become the input to f of x. So let's start out by finding g of 1. I'm just going to substitute 1 in for x. And we get 4 times 1 is equal to 4. And so now 4 is going to become the input into the function f. F of 4 is equal to 2 times 4 squared minus 3. And remember that we're going to square the 4 first. 4 squared is 16 times 2 would be 32 minus 3 gives us an answer of 29. So my output from the f function is 29. And that becomes my answer, or the output, for the composite function f of g of 1. Let's consider the next example. F of g of, g of f of 1. Now in this example, the functions have switched places. The 1 input value is still the same, but this time we're going to input 1 into the f function first. So 1 becomes the input into f, 2 times 1 squared minus 3. And if I square 1, that's still 1, times 2 is 2, minus 3, negative 1. So the output for f of 1 is negative 1, and that output becomes the input into g. So g of negative 1 is 4 times negative 1, which is equal to negative 4. And so the output of the composite of these two functions is equal to negative 4. Let's do one last example here. F of f of negative 2. Now this seems a little strange because both of the functions are f. What we're saying here is that we're going to input negative 2 into the function f, and then whatever the output is, that's going to become a new input into function f. So let's start with f of negative 2, and that is equal to 2 times negative 2 squared minus 3. And if I square negative 2, I get 4 times 2 is 8, minus 3 is 5. So the output of f for an input of negative 2 is 5. So now 5 is going to become our new input. And we're going to input 5 into f. 2 times 5 squared minus 3. And if I square 5, I get 25 times 2 is 50 minus 3, 47. And so the output of this composite function is 47. Pause the video and take a moment to try the next example on your own. In this next example for the first composite calculation, you should have gotten 98. For the second one, g of f of 2 was equal to 49. And for the last one, f of negative 1, you should have gotten negative 4. Now let's move on to a different type of example. Here we've got f of x equal to x squared plus 3x minus 1, and g of x equals 2x plus 3. And here we're just asked to find the composite function f of g of x, and then also to determine its domain. So let's think about what we're saying here. We're saying that the function g of x is going to be the input into f of x. And so that's going to look like this. Wherever I have an x, I'm going to input g of x, which is 2x plus 3. And that gets squared plus 3 times, and there I have another x in my f of x function. I'm going to input g of x, 2x plus 3. And then minus 1. So my f of x function is x squared plus 3x minus 1. And wherever we had an x, I substituted in g of x, which is 2x plus 3. And so now we need to multiply this out and simplify. 2x plus 3 squared is the same thing as 2x plus 3 times 2x plus 3. And so we need to multiply that out. Plus, I'm going to go ahead and distribute this 3. 3 times 2x would be 6x, and 3 times 3 is 9. And then we still have minus 1 on the end. Now let's go back to the 2x plus 3 squared, or 2x plus 3 times 2x plus 3. If I multiply 2x times 2x, I get 4x squared. 2x times 3 is 6x. 3 times 2x is 6x again, and 3 times 3 is 9. Plus 6x plus 9 minus 1. And now we're just ready to collect like terms and simplify. 4x squared plus, I have 6x plus 6x plus 6x, so that would be 18x. And then 9 plus 9 is 18 minus 1 is 17. And so our final composite function is 4x squared plus 18x plus 17. And that is equal to f of g of x. Now the second part of this question asked us to find the domain of this function. Well, my function here is a quadratic function. And I know that the domain of the quadratic function is all reals. Any x value can be input into the quadratic function. And so for the composite function, my domain is all reals. But when we consider domain, we need to also consider the two functions that go into the composite function. F of x equal to x squared plus 3x minus 1 is also a quadratic function. And so this domain is all reals. And then g of x is 2x plus 3, which is a linear function. Again, the domain is all reals. And since both of those domains are all reals, and our composite function is also a function with all reals, then that is our domain, all real numbers. So pause the video and take a moment to try the next example on your own. For your composite function, you should have gotten 2x squared plus 6x plus 1. And again, the domain is all real numbers. Let's look at another example like this. I have the function f of x is equal to 1 over x plus 2 and g of x equal to 3x minus 5. So g of x is going to be the function that's input into f of x. And so our composite function is going to look like this. 1 over, and where the x is, we're going to put 3x minus 5 plus 2. And so this is equal to 1 over 3x minus 3. So that's our composite function. F of g of x is equal to 1 over 3x minus 3. Now the next part of this question is to determine the domain of this function. And the domain, I jumped ahead a slide. Our domain, since we have a rational function, we do have a domain issue to consider here. You know that when we have a rational function, the denominator cannot be equal to 0. And so in this case, 3x minus 3 cannot be equal to 0, which means that 3x cannot equal 3, and x cannot equal 1. And just to make sure that that's our only domain issue, let's go back and think about, consider the domains of our two parts of the composite function. Actually, we really only need to consider the composite function that became the input. Since g of x is the input in our composite function, let's consider the domain of this function. It's a linear function whose domain is all reals. And so x can be anything for g of x, but then once we put g of x into f of x, that's when our domain issue comes up, because we end up with the rational function. And so since our input function g of x has a domain of all reals, then our domain for the composite function is going to be all reals, but x cannot be equal to 1. Again, pause the video, try the next one on your own. In this example, you should have gotten a composite function equal to 3 over 2x minus 3. The domain of our input function is all reals. And so for the domain of the composite function, we just need to set the denominator, not say that the denominator cannot equal 0. And we end up with the domain all reals, x not equal to 3/2. All right, let's look at another example like this. In this case, we have f of x is equal to the square root of 2x minus 4, g of x is equal to 3x plus 5. So let's find our composite function here. G of x is going to be input into f of x. And so f of x is the square root of 2 times x, and in place of x, I'm going to put 3x plus 5, and then we have minus 4. And so what we end up with here is the square root of 6x plus 10 minus 4, which is equal to the square root of 6x plus 6. And now for the second part of this question, we're asked to find the domain of this function. Again, let's consider the domain of our input function. Our input was g of x, and again, we have a linear function for g of x whose domain is all reals. So we have no restrictions on what's being put into g of x, and so we need to consider the domain of the composite function, which is the square root of 6x plus 6. Now, a square root function, that is one of the three functions with the limited domain. And for the square root function, whatever is underneath the radical, in this case 6x plus 6, it has to be greater than or equal to 0. Whenever we square root a number, it either has to be 0 or something positive. And so 6x must be greater than or equal to negative 6, and x must be greater than or equal to negative 1. And that would be our domain for this composite function. Pause the video. Try the next one on your own. Now in this example, you end up with the composite function x plus 4. And x plus 4 is just a linear function which does not have any limit on its domain. It does have a domain that is all real numbers. But your input function, g of x, does have a limited domain. Because it's a square root function, its domain is limited. And so when we consider the domain of the composite function, we have to consider the domain of g of x. Whatever's underneath the radical, in this case x plus 5, must be greater than or equal to 0. And so I end up with a domain of x greater than or equal to negative 5. So even though my linear function does not have a limited domain, the input function g of x did have a limited domain, and that ends up limiting the domain of the composite function as well. I believe we have one last example here. In this last example, we're simply being asked to identify the two functions that make up this composite function. So f of g of x is equal to x squared plus 1 cubed. And so the question here is, what is f of x and what is g of x? Well, g of x is our inside function, the function that's being input into f of x. And if you look at the composite function here, hopefully you can see that the inside function would be the x squared plus 1. Another way to think about this is if you have a value for x, like let's say that I tell you x equals 2. F of g of 2. The question is, what are you going to do to 2 first? Well, if we substitute 2 into this composite function, the first thing that we would do to 2, according to the order of operations, is that we would square 2, and then we would add 1. And so that means that that is our inside function. Whatever the first function is that you would do to x, if you have a value for it, that's your inside function. And so for this example, g of x is equal to x squared plus 1, because that's the first thing that we would do if we knew what the value of x was. We would square it and then add 1. Now the outside function here in this case is the cubic function, the cubing of whatever we get from x squared plus 1, because once we find out what is the value inside the parentheses is, then we would cube it. And so my f of x function here is equal to x cubed. One last time, pause the video and try the next one on your own. In this last example, you should have identified g of x, the inside function, as being x minus 2, and f of x, the outside function, as natural log of x. We will complete the practice problems in class on Monday. See you then.